people have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show with Pakistan, which has started its vaccination drive this week. The major takeaway, however, is that it is using Chinese vaccines that are already under scanner for their dubious efficacy rate. The Pakistan government, however, has cautioned its senior citizens to not get it administered, for it shows no results on elderlies.
After days of a political build-up in the country, Islamabad, in presence of Prime Minister Imran Khan, launched vaccination drive this week. While the country's own campaign of developing a vaccine is undergoing clinical trials under Chinese watch, it has received some 500,000 Sinopharm vaccines from Beijing. Pakistan will vaccinate its doctors and healthcare workers in the first phase. It will also be receiving 17 million India-made Covishield vaccines through COVAX route, the World Health Organization's drive to provide vaccines to countries.
We have 5 lakh vaccines, which I will tell you all. First of all, as we have given to the doctor, we will give to the health workers काम करते हैं कोरोना के मरीजों के साथ तो उनको सबसे पहले और उसके बाद फिर एक एज ग्रुप जो कि जिस एज में ज्यादा खतरा है कोरोना का उसको उनको लगेंगी
The question, however, arises is that why Pakistan is risking its citizens' life with Chinese vaccines that are not being trusted by people across the world. Only a few days back, one of its vaccines was rejected by Brazil for its dismal efficacy performance. Has it given in to the pressure created by Beijing to save its free-falling reputation in the world? Or it is neglecting the potential threats that others have seen? While Pakistan has announced that it will not be vaccinating its 60-plus people with Chinese vaccines, the experts around the world have raised apprehension over its use on remaining people too. China has spent around $70 billion in Pakistan and has used its deep pockets to influence almost everything in the country. No wonder the vaccines are being administered by Pakistan. Meanwhile, India, which has emerged as a savior in the pandemic, has ramped its fight against the virus. Apart from developing and distributing millions of doses, New Delhi has boosted its healthcare spending by 135% in the budget unveiled for this year.
I would like to say that the investment on health infrastructure in this budget has increased substantially, progressively. As institutions absorb more, we shall commit more. Taking a holistic approach to health, we focus on strengthening three areas: preventive, curative, and well-being.
New Delhi will be spending over $30 billion in healthcare and immunization in the coming year. The country has already received a shot in the arm for its sustained and comprehensive efforts to contain the spread of the pandemic. The single-day graph has come down from nearly 100,000 cases a day in mid-September to around 10,000 cases per day in the past several days. But not everybody has followed the assertive model. While the government in Pakistan was repeatedly accused of being laid back during the pandemic, low testing and underreporting hasn't been able to measure the real impact of the virus in the country, with many COVID deaths reported as natural or because of other causes.
moving on. After establishing itself as a major IT and agriculture power, India is now looking to expand its defense capabilities. In the recently held biennial mega air show in South Indian city of Bengaluru, India projected itself as a regional defense supplier. The government has recently signed a deal worth $6.5 billion to home produce 83 light combat fighter jets Tejas in India. New Delhi says it plans to sell other major defense equipments that it has become capable of producing in abundance.
The 13th edition of the Aero India International Air Show 2021 was not just different from the COVID perspective, but for an additional component, that it marked the beginning of new era for India. The country, which has till date been seen as a prospective buyer for major defense equipments, is now willing to sell it. While traditional American and Russian defense manufacturers showcased their technology at the event, India too put up its armed production before the world. It witnessed diverse participation from countries like Iran, Ukraine, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka as visitors. The three-day show featured participation by 530 exhibitors, 457 Indian exhibitors and 74 foreign exhibitors from around the world, 9 foreign primes and several large and MSME industries from India.
Most importantly for us, we're very excited we were able to bring the B-1 bomber here. The first time that we've had this aircraft or a bomber in India since India's independence. So it's a very exciting time for us, and we're really happy to be here. And it's a world-class event. It just doesn't get better than Aero India, so we're real happy to be here.
While India didn't even produce for its own requirement until a few years back, the dynamics have changed drastically in past few years. And the numbers speak for themselves, with export figures rising to double in comparison to what it was 2 years ago. The government aims to export around $5 billion worth Indian ammunition to the world. India says, in order to counter the growing challenges in the region, the country and its allies will have to equip itself with sophisticated technology so that the enemy can be deterred.
The Indian aerospace and defense industry present an attractive and significant opportunity for foreign companies across the supply chain to take their cooperation to newer levels. India is ready to supply various types of missile systems, light combat aircraft, helicopters, multi-purpose light transport aircraft, warship and patrol vessels, artillery gun systems, tanks, radar, military vehicles, electronic warfare system and other weapon systems to IOR countries.
A day after the Indian Air Force handed over an order of 83 indigenous light combat aircraft Tejas to Hindustan Aeronautics Limited, a number of Middle East and Southeast Asian countries have expressed their interest in the indigenous LCA Tejas Mk1A fighter at a vanilla price under $42 million. Currently, India exports defense equipments to 42 countries. However, the equipments do not fall in major ammunition category, and that is the change new mission is going to bring in coming times.
Moving on. A protracted Afghan war has crippled the Afghan economy, so much so that half of the Afghan population is in dire need of fundamental assistance. The humanitarian wing of the European Union has said that the country would require additional aid for its people to meet the basic needs this year. And while the new Washington dispensation is mulling a review of the peace deal signed last year, a ramped up Taliban offensive is making things worse with each passing day.
An overwhelming number of Afghans are succumbing to extreme levels of poverty and hunger every year, with millions of children, adults and elderly failing to meet everyday calorie needs. A stagnant economy, compounded by a rising number of Taliban attacks, has ensured this gloomy situation for years, and the crisis doesn't seem to be going away anytime soon. Kabul receives hundreds of thousands of dollars in aid every year, but that is just not enough to sustain millions of Afghans who cannot earn even a square meal per day owing to violence and unavailability of jobs. The COVID-19 pandemic has only added to the woes. Both unemployment and poverty has surged. A recent analysis by the European Union says that half of the country is in dire need of more assistance.
The humanitarian needs are rising globally and also in Afghanistan for various reasons, primarily because of the conflict, the violence as we see continues in the country, but also due to the pandemic of COVID-19. And other challenges, including the natural disasters that often affect this country.
The situation in Afghanistan has only worsened in the past 12 months. A report by the Special Inspector General for Afghanistan Reconstruction says that there was a 17% rise in poverty in 2020, with the unemployment rate hovering at 38%. UN Humanitarian Affairs Office calculated that the United Nations will require an additional $1.3 billion in 2021 for humanitarian aid in Afghanistan, as the number of people who require assistance will have doubled compared to a year ago. While donors have pledged $12 billion in the next 4 years, the European Union has allocated an extra sum of over $38 million.
The situation of internally displaced people in Afghanistan is a matter of urgency. There has to be effective action to address their needs. European Union is ready to help also in this respect. The initial allocation of humanitarian aid by the European Union for Afghanistan for this year is 32 million euro. This is initial allocation. It may increase over the year, but with this allocation, we have already reached more than 1 billion euro since mid-90s in humanitarian aid from the European Union to Afghanistan.
Meanwhile, a bipartisan report to US Congress hinted at the troops not leaving Afghanistan by May 1st, a date that was agreed upon by the previous US dispensation for complete withdrawal. It has asked for the extension and urged for contingent cuts only after confirming progress in peace talks and reduction in violence by Taliban. While it comes as a major takeaway from the Biden administration, it remains to be seen how Taliban, which blames US presence as one of the principal reasons behind the violence in Afghanistan, takes it.
The uncertainty over Rohingya refugees' future has grown even bigger with Myanmar, their home, plunging into a deep political crisis after the Myanmar military staged a coup and took over the reins of the country. Faced with Dhaka's relocation drive, the dejected refugees say even their limited hopes of repatriation are now over. And these developments will only add hardships and sufferings to their already bleak sustenance.
A military coup in Southeast Asian country of Myanmar has not just prompted turbulence in diplomatic circuits around the world, but has also trampled upon the hopes of hundreds of thousands of Rohingya refugees who want to return homes from the overcrowded camps in Bangladesh's Cox's Bazar. They feel the prospects and paths that lead to their villages will be closed forever, as the same military, which they blame for driving them out of their homes, has taken control of Myanmar, with democratic leader Aung San Suu Kyi and the president of the country under detention. Meanwhile, Bangladesh has urged Myanmar to make genuine efforts to move forward the stalled process of voluntary repatriation of Rohingya Muslim refugees. It has sheltered more than 1 million Rohingyas for over 3 years after they fled violence in Buddhist-majority Myanmar, where most of them are denied citizenship. A UN-backed repatriation process has failed to take off despite multiple attempts from Bangladesh. Recently, it started sending some refugees to an isolated island in the Bay of Bengal. A few news organizations that have traveled the island call it a relatively better place. But the refugees want a permanent solution. They want United Nations to intervene and rescue them from what appears to be a never-ending crisis. Many observers fear that the military coup can push fresh influx of Rohingya refugee to Bangladesh. They say the remaining Rohingya in Rakhine state are now even more vulnerable. In such a scenario, it is hard to fathom where the Rohingya crisis is headed, and even hard to come to terms with the fact that these refugees, a million of them living in abject poverty, are destined to live like this forever, or maybe even in worse conditions.
An avenue that showcases Indian tribal products and helps artisans connect with the mainstream population has been the National Tribal Craft Exhibition named Adi Mahotsav, the fortnight expo which recently kicked off on a grand note in capital New Delhi. Tribes from different parts of the country took part and displayed various products to visitors. Let's have a look at this colorful grand expo.
India has always been known as the land that portrays its cultural and traditional vitality through its beautiful craft products. Tribal art and craft in India is simple and ethnic, yet colorful and vibrant, reflecting the country's rich cultural heritage. In a bid to promote art, craft, cuisines and culture in the national and international platform, New Delhi is hosting the fortnight exhibition of Adi Mahotsav.
this is a national tribal festival, which is called Adi Mahotsav. And about this gives 1,000 tribal artisans who reside in the dense forests and heartlands of the country access to large markets. Our tribal artisans are world-class producers, wonderful artisans. They make world-class things.
Over 1,000 tribal artisans from different Indian states have participated, creating a mini mela. The 15-day long mega event will celebrate and cherish the spirit of tribal culture and commerce. The main aim is to represent the basic ethos of tribal life and accelerating economic development among the poor and to provide wider exposure to their artifacts in domestic as well as international markets. The festival is a feature exhibition cum sale of tribal handicrafts, paintings, fabrics, jewelries, shawls and much more through 200 stalls. The famous handmade shawls from Himachal Pradesh by local artisans and other master tribal craftsmen are attracting large numbers of visitors.
हमारा प्रोडक्ट बेसिकली कुल्लू शॉल्स है हमारा इसी में ही काम रहता है कुल्लू पट्टी में कुल्लू शॉल हम बनाते हैं और हमारा जो प्रोडक्ट है ये प्योर शिप वूल में बनता है एक शॉल को बनाने में कम से कम एक दिन और जो मैक्सिमम जो बड़ा डिज़ाइन होता है उसके लिए कम से कम 10 से 12 दिन लग जाता है
The tribal textile manufactured by master craftsmen from Jammu and Kashmir in the north to Tamil Nadu in the south and from Gujarat in the west to Nagaland and Sikkim in the east is grabbing eyeballs. A display of tribal jewelry from different states reflected the effervescent tribal beauty and ethnicity. Even varieties of bamboo crafts and organic food products in the festival are pulling both domestic and international crowd as well. Besides that, various types of lip-smacking delicacies, vibrant and colorful tribal dance and songs are being showcased at the festival.
We had food from Sikkim stall, the momos. They were fabulous, excellent. And now we are trying to explore the other cuisines of India. But the first experience was the best. If your first experience is the best, then everything is going to be best, hopefully. And it was a nice change for us to come here and see things around.
The magical, mystical of Tribal India finds expression at Tribes India, the exclusive shop of tribal artifacts espousing tribal cause. By organizing such kinds of grand exhibitions, the people in and outside India gets a chance to see the diversity of the country.
Adi Mahotsav is also an opportunity for the artisans to interact directly with art lovers and get first-hand feedback, which can then better their creations and designs. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.